baptism is. Baptism is done for the forgiveness of sins, Acts 2:38. Baptism is done to save us, 1 Peter 3:21, Acts 2:40, Mark 16:16. Baptism is done to wash away our sins, Acts 22:16. Baptism is done to be reborn to new life, John 3:5, Romans 6:3-6. Baptism is done to clothe ourselves with Christ, Galatians 3:26 and 27.
Trust in the Lord with all your hearts, and lean not into your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him, and He shall direct your path.
I need you, Lord. I need you, Lord, right now. I need you, Lord. I need you, Lord, right now. I lift my hands, I bow my knees, and worship at your throne. I need you, Lord. I need you, Lord, right now.
If you feel that way, lift your voice and sing it. Somebody fill your mouth with praise and love the Lord. I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord. Hallelujah. Clap your hands to the Lord and give Him praise. Oh, what an awesome God we serve. What an awesome God we serve. We worship you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Give the Lord another hand clap of praise tonight. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise God. What a privilege it is to be here tonight at Passing the Torch. I don't know how many times it is that I've been here, but every time I have come and been a part of this conference, I have left blessed. And I give honor to the God of this house, as well as the man of God of this house. Amen. How many love Brother Paul Elder? Amen. Thank God for Brother Elder. Amen. I was in a meeting one time where Brother Elder was with my father. And in fact, I think it was here. And they were recognizing the younger elder. And they were recognizing the older young. And so whenever young and elder get together, we're all mixed up. Amen. I love Brother and Sister Elder and Jeffrey and Mitchell. Amen. I thank God for this family. Amen. And then all of the men of God that are here, the speakers and the sponsors. I have been blessed, and good to see Brother and Sister Freeze, amen, doing a great work in Colorado, and then all of my friends, amen. I love the men of God of this church, and Brother Randy Williams is like my little brother, and I love his family, and I'm looking around here. I got so many friends and new friends and old friends. We go way back, and evangelists and elders that are here today. I love them and thank God for them. Amen. Are y'all ready for the word of the Lord? You know, I was kind of on point. Brother Elder and I were together last week, and he said, I want you to preach if you feel it in the Holy Ghost. You're on that Friday slot. And he kind of nudged me in a certain direction. And then lo and behold, there was a situation where my good friend, Brother Urshan, was unable to be here tonight. Because now, if some of you came to hear Brother Urshan, you got stuck with me. As ushers stopped them as they're leaving, amen. Our prayers are with him. I had to deal with the situation. And I know he would be here if he could. And so my slot got moved from Friday morning to Friday night. And I was saying, God, what is it that you've got for me to preach? Because what I was planning on teaching didn't really fit for Friday night. And while we were praying after Brother Johnson's message, how many were blessed by the move of the Holy Ghost that happened in here after Brother Johnson preached? I was sitting right over there about where Brother Cass is standing, or somewhere over there. And as I was praying, I felt it was very clear what God had directed me to. And so I have gone back to the hotel room the last couple of days since that. And I feel clarity in the Holy Ghost. And I'm excited for what God's going to do tonight. Are y'all ready to have some church tonight? Amen. If you have your Bible, let's turn to the book of Mark. Mark chapter 9 and verse 14. Amen. What a great time we have had. Amen. I give honor to the pastors that are here, the evangelists. Amen. These are good evangelists. If you're a pastor, have these evangelists come preach for you. And to my good friend, Brother Alviar, missionary to Brazil. Amen. I thank God for what he's doing in Brazil. And have this missionary get behind what they're doing. They're trying to complete a campground that's going to seat a camp meeting auditorium, going to seat about 1,200. Amen. I thank God for missionaries with vision. Amen. So if you're listening on Holy Ghost Radio, get behind a cause bigger than yourself. Amen. Brother Hoffer, you're doing a great job. How many are thankful for Holy Ghost Radio? Amen. Amen. Mark chapter 9 and verse 14. And when he, speaking of Jesus, came to his disciples, he saw a great multitude about them and the scribes. Everybody say, and the scribes. Questioning with them. And straightway all the people, when they beheld him, were greatly amazed, and running to him, saluted or greeted him. He asked the scribes, what question ye with them? And one of the multitude answered and said, Master, I have brought unto thee my son, which hath a dumb spirit. Some of you fathers are thinking your kid's got a dumb spirit. And wheresoever he taketh him, he teareth him, and he foameth, and gnasheth with his teeth, and pineth away. And I spake to thy disciples that they should cast him out, and they could not. So they are telling what the discussion has been about. And Jesus answered him and said, O faithless generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I suffer you? Bring him unto me. And they brought him unto Jesus and unto him. And when he saw him, straightway the spirit tear him. And he fell on the ground and wallowed foaming. And Jesus, and he asked his father, how long is it ago since this came upon him? And he said, of a child, or since he was a child, and oftentimes it hath cast him into the fire and into the waters to destroy him. But if thou canst do anything, have compassion on us and help us. Jesus said unto him, if thou canst believe, all things are possible to him that believeth. Will you read that last phrase with me out loud like you're preaching tonight? All things start there. All things are possible to him that believeth. And straightway the father of the child cried out and said with tears, Lord, I believe. Help thou mine unbelief. Lord, I believe. Help thou my unbelief. And it is from that last clause that I take my title. It'll make sense maybe in a little while. And I titled this sermon, The Masquerade. The Masquerade. Give the Lord a hand clap of praise right now. And while you're clapping, ask the Holy Ghost to move in here upon every life, upon every heart, upon every mind, soul, body, and spirit, upon every pastor, upon every preacher, upon every missionary, upon every father and mother, upon every one of us. God, let the power, come on, clap your hands and lift your voice. Let the power of the Holy Ghost touch us today. Let us leave passing the torch filled with power, filled with faith, filled with an anointing to go home and change our community with the gospel. Somebody shout hallelujah. Amen. Before you're seated, turn around to somebody and say, the mask has got to come off. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You may be seated in the name of the Lord. Amen. The masquerade. This summer, my family and I went to Europe and spent some time in various places. And the last stop on our trip was to the city of Venice. It's a place that I had long wanted to visit and was also the place my wife and children wanted to go. And so we had scheduled several days there. And we fell in love with its beauty, uniqueness. And I went home after doing what little research I was able to on vacation. I wanted to find out more about this unique place. Venice is a city in Italy known long ago as Venezia. And it is a beautiful, strange, exotic, romantic spot in northern Italy. It's a place, I don't know if you've been there, you owe it to yourself if you can to get there at some point. If not, just look at some pictures and glad you came to church tonight. At least you'll get a little geography lesson. It's a beautiful spot with a maze of canals and alleyways and bridges. Some of the islands that are created by these canals may be as small as 200 by 200 yards wide. It's actually made up of 118 different islands made by the canals that are there. And it holds a unique place in history. You see, there was really no such thing as Italy until 1861. Prior to that time, it was an area or region of Europe that was made up of what we would call city-states. We would know some of them. We recognize them as styles of food, or we recognize them in our large cities as subdivisions or communities, Tuscany or Piedmont or Venice or Genoa or even Sicily. These are the different areas of what we now know as Italy, but these were actually city-states that were based largely by and upon what had been tribal communities. And Venice was begun to be settled as early as the 9th century BC. And then as time would progress, these refugees from different tribal regions, as Rome began to take hold and begin to take dominion, many of them fled these Roman cities and communities and arrived and established this particular city-state on these small group of islands. There it was protected and is protected by the Adriatic Sea. As time has gone, they tell us that Venice is sinking, and I saw evidence of that while I was there. But many years ago, it was positioned on purpose. They established their community in this portion of islands on the Adriatic Sea because it was just a common thing where these tribal areas or these city-states would war against each other. We know of these from Greek history. We know about the Spartans that were from Sparta, who had prided themselves upon their military might. And that historical precedent had been set, and these tribal areas of what we now call Italy would invade one another. And so this group had found protection in the islands on the sea, and they were now safe from the raiding horsemen that would come and the Huns that would invade. And so they were protected. And so as a result, Venice would become the capital of what would be the Venetian Republic. And here, Venezia would be the ruling center of prosperity and blessing and favor for nearly 800 years. Now, we think of America as being around a while, but we're just a baby in comparison to 800 years of prosperity. Venice had enjoyed the position of unrivaled superiority. It would become the wealthiest city in Europe, and in fact, the most extravagant. Here was an exotic island, canals and bridges with small islands and small communities, and each of these islands would take its own little particular area, and upon every single island the Catholic Church would build another Catholic Church. And you could actually stand at the door of one Catholic Church, and if the alley didn't turn, you could look maybe 500 yards away and find another church. And they were there bound by these communities, and so this was the parish of, and there are 118 churches on 118 different islands. And so now you have a beautiful, exotic, religious, wealthy, and extravagant community. And because of its location, the maritime industry began to prosper. They were skilled and gifted at their trade. And shipyards began to be produced. And so Venice would be able to turn out a battleship every 30 days. And so as a result, craftsmen came and builders came, and so the tradesmen came, but along with it came the money that flowed through this exotic, protected place. And so now through the shipping industry, suddenly silk and grain and salt and spice and gold and silver and brass and iron begin to come to be used and crafted and molded into whatever could be shipped to the other parts of the world. And so as a result, along with the craft, along with the gifts, along with the money, yeah, you know, everything else started coming. And at first it was the beauty and the attractive, and it was the artists and the poets, the philosophers and the politicians. But then came the con men, then came the actors and the prostitutes and the pimps, along with the writers and the musicians. And some of them, we know a lot about what they wrote. You've heard no doubt about Lord Byron. He was one of the citizens. And young ladies and young men, he's the one that gave that famous quote, "Friendship may often grow into love, but love never subsides into friendship." So when they tell you, let's just be friends, it's over. When that guy said, you know, let's just cool it and let's just be friends, just young lady, understand, it's over. We learned that from Lord Byron, but he wasn't the only expert on love. That was the home of Casanova, the world's greatest lover, supposedly. He was from Venice, and so he had all of his ideas, and Lord Byron spouting his ideas. And then there was that merchant explorer who told us about Asia. When he came back to find his city at war, he was arrested, and there he told a cellmate. His name was Marco Polo. That's all in Venice. And then there was the great Baroque composer. Most composers I know are Baroque. Vivaldi, because there were four conservatories of music, and so some of the greatest music that is ever played, even to this day, is played in Venice. And if you were to go to St. Mark's Square all throughout the night up until midnight, there are roving bands of classical musicians that take turns playing, and it comes from a long line of gifted musicians that came to this beautiful exotic place of wealth. So now you've got craftsmen, and you've got beauty, and you've got poets, and you've got writers, and now coming with it, cloistered in this little group of 118 islands, filled with all of the wealth that you can imagine. It's rolling in, it's protected, 800 years of prosperity heaped upon one another, crowded into a small, confined area, a cloistered, wealthy, protected, rich, extravagant community. Not much is going out. It's all coming in. You've got wealth beyond what we could even comprehend. I listened as one of the historians was making a presentation. He said at one point, the people of Venice were so wealthy, they would take gold coins and throw them into the canal to display how much they could throw away. This is the point where they had need of nothing. Money is not an object, and they are wealthy beyond our able ability to comprehend. And here in this exotic, romantic, strange place, a strange cultural phenomenon took place that is unlike anything that has ever happened in human history. A social culture of masks developed. No one is exactly sure the date it started. Nobody can really explain what was the cause. But when you arrive in Venice, on every store, on every advertisement, on every picture you see, you'll see a beautifully decorated mask, and everybody's talking about masquerade. See, what happened is the Venetians began to conceal their identity, because behind a mask you could hide. You're living cloistered and closed up, and you've got wealth, and you've got extravagance, and you've got exoticness, and you've got Casanova, and you've got Vivaldi, and you've got Lord Byron, and this whole idea is beginning to roll through a wealthy, extravagant community. And so behind a mask, a servant could be mistaken for a noble. The state could ask a question, and a citizen could answer without fear of reprisal. You could report on your neighbor anonymously, and you could spy in secret. A nun could be a harlot, and a priest could be a pimp. Because your true identity was hidden behind the masquerade. Behind the mask, culture became decadent. And so now those that were to be respected could play in their vices without fear of anyone identifying them. And their actions in the evening would not affect what they did in the business place or the religious house tomorrow. You could actually steal and no one could identify you. You could commit adultery and nobody would report. You could live a life of religion and fornication at the same time. And lewdness could be on display without identifying the culprit. The only thing I could even imagine that's even close is the internet, where you can have a secret life. It started for business. History says it started occasionally, but the amazing thing is it captured the culture of Venice to the point that there was over 1 year it had to be outlawed, because every single citizen was captured by the idea of masks. that it was so much a part of their culture that when they woke up in the morning, before they left their house, every citizen in Venice would place their mask on, and life became a daily grind of masquerade. Every day you got up and put the mask on. While flying home from Europe, I was reading my Bible, and my eyes read the text that we read. And at first I didn't think of any connection. After a while, it just kind of ate on me. And my mind began to journey down the verses of this text. Mark's narrative provides for us the return of Jesus from atop the mountain of transfiguration. And as Jesus and Peter, James, and John are coming down the trail from the mountain, ahead of them is the multitude the text told us about. And there Jesus' eyes fall upon a crowd that is gathered around a group of scribes, and they seem to be in intense discussion. And as they approach, the multitude, the Bible tells us, recognizes Jesus coming, and the attention turns, and verse 14 said, and all the people running saluted or greeted him. Now, there's no idle words in the Bible. It's not like your thesis paper for your class, final test. There's nothing, you know, you got to get to that 500 word mark, and so you add the therefores, and it would behoove all of us. And I know about all that too. The Bible doesn't have any of that. The Bible says, and especially Mark, he's very to the point about what is taking place. And here the crowd and the multitude turn to greet him. And the Bible says, notice the scribes are there. Everybody say the scribes. The multitude is there. The scribes are there. And the Bible said in verse 17, and one of the multitude answered. I don't know how big the multitude was. It didn't say a dozen. It didn't say 100. It said a multitude. And right there, I want you to begin to notice with me, there's something bigger going on than just a narrative of Jesus' history. Jesus approaches wanting to know what the discussion is about. I don't know how long the pause was. I don't know how long it was before the multitude is waiting, but the Bible says, and one. Everybody say, and one. And one of the multitude answered. Something in that one man stepped out of the crowd. One man breaks rank from the multitude. The setting is a multitude and scribes. To get the full picture of this, what is a scribe? We just kind of run past that word. I don't know if you've ever taken the time, or maybe it's been a while since you remembered what a scribe did. In those days, there was no photocopy machine. There was no computer to print out something. You didn't just go run get a copy of so-and-so's book or so-and-so's a paper. So the scribes were of the educated elite. Not many people could read and write. And so to have the position of a scribe was to not only indicate you were very educated, but you were also of wealthy position, because everything that had to be done legally, you were involved. There it was done by hand. The scribes were the educated. They were the money makers. They were involved in every business transaction that required covenants and documents. They were in kings' palaces. They were in lawyers' courts. They were in rulers' places. They were with judges, and they were with governments. And then for a Jewish scribe, there was a whole nother level. They were the holy men, the in-position men. These were generational positions where father trained son and son trained his son, and wealth had built upon wealth through centuries of being in the scribe position. They had and held to a strict adherence to scribal code of ethics. And here it was, if you were to be a scribe, you didn't just put yours down on anything. There was a particular cleansing that had to be done upon the animal skin upon which you would write. And then you just couldn't write anyway if you were a Jewish scribe. Each line, everybody say each line. Each line could have no less than 48 in the line. No page could have it at less than 48 lines, but no more than 60 lines on the page. So you're starting to see all of this has got to be very to the point and very according to the rules. And every word you transcribed, you had to say out loud. And what you were writing could only be done with a specific ink. And that ink could only be used if it had been built by a particular ink recipe. And every time you approached the word God, you had to clean the pen and stop and wash your entire body. And this is the group that is in the crowd discussing what's going on. They're very rules oriented. They're very to the point. They're very much into audit. They're very much in making sure everything just right and making sure everything is up to snuff. They're very much into taking notes and asking questions and making sure everything is dotted and crossed. And it's to this multitude and group that Jesus approaches in what I think is one of the most poignant moments in Scripture. But I got a question. Is this the only guy that's got an issue? This is a multitude of people. And when Jesus approaches, only one guy says, I got a problem. Everybody's hanging out with the scribes and everybody's debating. No doubt those scribes are debating Jesus' disciples. And we understand there's been a little something that's going on before Jesus gets there. But I just want to tell you, I'm a pastor. I look down in the altar on Sunday, and in my altar, in a little church I'm starting on the north side of town, in that little group of only about 50 people, I looked down into the eyes of a woman whose husband had been a preacher that committed adultery on her and walked away. I looked across on the other side, and there was a young lady who had seen her daddy abuse her mother. I looked back to the middle, and there was a girl that had been gang raped in the last 2 years. That's in a little group, and beside them stood a foster child who had been one from one abusive family to the next. And that was just 52 people on Sunday afternoon. I wonder about the multitude that day. But only one guy. Jesus says, what's going on, guys? Nobody says anything except just one man. Multitude is listening and the scribes are ready to take notes. And he says, key verse, I have spoken to your disciples. Which seems to indicate, Brother Elder, that there's been a private conversation that seems to be growing to the point it's become uncomfortable. And there must have been some kind of debate, because he says, I went to your disciples, but they were unable to help me. It hasn't worked. Jesus said, what's the situation? My son, then he lays out the issue. My son's got a devil. Bring him to me. How many is glad Jesus still says, bring your needs to me? Verse 23, are you with me? Is this all right? Jesus looks at him and says, if thou canst believe, all things are possible. Pay attention right here. I'm through with my introduction. I'm ready to preach. I'm preaching about the masquerade. What's the problem? Sir, I've got a need. And I brought it to your disciples. They couldn't help me. Bring him to me. If you can believe, all things are possible. The Bible turns so quickly right here. And the Father cried out and said with tears. That word cried out in the original means croaked out or screamed. There's been private conversation with disciples. I'm trying to operate in the, I'm in a multitude here and you're the disciples and maybe you can help me out here. I can see this private conversation as he's approached and said, I've got a situation with my child and could you help me out here? And they're not able. And so now you've got scribes and they're in debate. Well, this didn't work because you didn't have enough faith. And it didn't happen because, you know, it's not a time. And I can hear all of this debate that's going on. And the multitude, Jesus shows up and the man says, I've gone to your disciples. They've been unable to help me. And the Lord says, if you can believe, all things are possible. And at this point right here, something in this man breaks. This is not an easy thing. At this point, it's no longer trying to merge in with the crowd and just get through life. But at this point, he is going to expose himself and reveal his deepest need. He is now moving behind and away from closed, private, hushed conversations. This is now a man, Brother Freeze, at the point of desperation, where he doesn't care what anybody else thinks. Before, he's been behind the mask of just getting by and private conversation with those that are connected. Maybe you could help me out. And the scribes in conversation. But something, when Jesus said, if you've got faith, if you'll only believe, all things are possible. And at that point, he said, I'm taking this mask off. I can't hide behind it anymore. I don't care how I look like. I don't care what the bomb, I may be the only one, but I'm getting this mask off. And he reaches up and he takes it off and he screams and it's like a hurting croak that comes out of him. And he said, God, I believe, but help my unbelief. I believe, but help my unbelief. The mask is off. The masquerade is over. I can't take it one more day. I know I believe in God. You know I believe on my God. I'm here in this multitude. I've been waiting for you to come down off that mountain. If I didn't believe, I wouldn't be talking to your disciples. I believe in you. But God, help my unbelief. I may look like a fool. I know those scribes are going to judge me and write everything down. And they're used to keeping records. And it's going to be all over the forum before nightfall. Everybody's going to know I got issues. And everybody's going to know my baby's got problems. And everybody's going to know everything in my house ain't right. But I can't take it one more day. I'm getting this mask off. I believe God, but you got to help my unbelief. Can I preach on this last night? It's time to take the mask off. I'm not here to cause you to doubt your belief. You wouldn't be here if you didn't believe. But I'm honest tonight. There's a whole lot of people, they don't doubt their God. They don't doubt Jesus' name baptism. They believe one God from the top of the head to the sole of their feet. It ain't their belief that's the problem. I pastor people. There ain't nothing wrong with what they believe. It's their unbelief that's the problem. You may be seated. I'm preaching to people that got issues. The problem is not what you believe. That's not the issue. Can I just follow the Holy Ghost tonight? Pastor, your belief system isn't the problem. You believe in holiness and separation. You believe in Jesus' name, baptism. You believe in living for God and putting in a good week's worth of study and dedication. There's nothing wrong with your believing. It's that other stuff. It's that other stuff that nobody else sees. It's that issue in your home. It's that issue in your health. Is that issue that you just put the mask on and get up and preach every Sunday and get up and preach every Wednesday? I'm not even talking about sin tonight. That's another subject. I'm talking about the pain in your life that you've got covered up, and you get up and you sing every song and you preach every sermon and you get up and you go through your duty because that's what you do. There ain't nothing wrong with your belief system. But the problem is you got some hurt down on the inside that you said, God, I believe you. You know I believe you. I've preached, I've sung, I've knocked doors. But God, I got some problems in my own house. And God, I got some doubts, and I've lost some faith, and I've got some things that I don't have answers for. And the devil gets in your brain and gets in your spirit and beats you up and condemns you. It ain't your faith in God that's the problem. It's you've got an unbelief that says it may never happen. I know I'm in the Holy Ghost tonight. Lord, I believe. You got to help my unbelief. Brother Lee, what's it like to travel and preach? You preached in my church. Yes. And you preach healing. And you preach deliverance. But yet you're sitting there in those shoes and you got diabetes. It ain't your belief that's the problem. I know what I'm preaching about here today. There are people in this room. Your doctrine's right. Your belief in God is right. You got your sleeves right. Your skirt right. You're living for God. You got the TV out of your house. You don't go to that. That ain't your problem. But down in your heart, you got problems in your health. And you got a backslid baby. You got a backslid teenager. You got a lost loved one. And you said, God, I believe you, but you got to help my unbelief. What about a saint of God? God, I repented of my sins. I got baptized in Jesus' name. You filled me with the Holy Ghost. I know that's true. But you got hurt by the church somewhere. God, I believe. But you got to help my unbelief because your disciples let me down. God, I put my trust in my family. My family turned their back on me. God, I paid my tithe and gave my offering, and then my family cheated me out of money. God, I was faithful. I gave in that missions offering to help buy that new building and get through the asbestos fire. God, I did that, and then somebody heard me. It ain't your belief that's a problem. It's your unbelief. Because you've been hurt. You've been let down. Life hasn't unfolded for you. God, if I didn't believe you, I wouldn't be here with this multitude. I wouldn't even be at passing the torch if I didn't believe. But while I'm preaching, you're sitting there. And all hell is in your insides. As you think about everybody that's done your baby wrong. How your husband walked away. You feel like God's let you down. And your marriage broke up. And your kids messed up. And some of you got a kid strung out on drugs tonight. Oh, you never doubted Jesus' name baptism. When you go to bed at night, all you can see is a baby on the way to hell. Tonight, I'm done preaching. Musicians, come. It's time to take the mask off. It's time, whether you're a preacher, you're a pastor, an evangelist, a saint of God, a Sunday school teacher, a saint. I don't care what position or what title or what lack of title you got. I'm not here to castigate you that you don't believe one God and hold it. My God, you wouldn't even be at this conference if you didn't. But I'm challenging some of you that are short of victory. This thing's fixing to change. I know it's heavy right now, but there's going to be a lifting in here. Because there was something that happened, Brother Charles. That man had been in conversation. What's the conversation about? Well, I went to your disciples. They couldn't help me out. What's the problem, my son? It's almost like conversational. And he looks at him and said, if you'll only believe, all things are possible. I don't know what it was right there, Brother Elder. But when he said, all things are possible, something in that man's spirit turned over. Suddenly, he didn't care who was in the room. He didn't care who was on the trail that day. He didn't care how many was keeping records and how many was on the internet tweeting what he was talking about. He didn't care if everybody started gossiping about his son. He didn't care if his son looked like a fool in front. He didn't care if he looked like an idiot father who had lost his mind. Something in him, Brother Clack, right there, said, I ain't going one step further in this mask. I'm taking it off. And he took it off and he said, Lord, I believe, but you got to help me right now because I got some bitterness. I've got some hurt. I've got some anger. I've got some resentment. Your disciples have let me down, but I ain't going one step further until you fix this problem right here. If there is somebody, there may be only one in this multitude tonight that is desperate enough to forget what your friends think. Forget what you don't care what your pastor friends think. Yeah, don't care what the missionaries think. And don't care what the elders think. Don't even care what your kids think. If there's somebody that is tired of the masquerade, that is desperate enough to get up from where you're sitting right now, say, I'm not leaving this place tonight until you help my unbelief. See, that was what the problem was. Because in one moment, Jesus set that boy free. If there's anybody right now said, I'm not staying there one more moment. I'm getting this mask off and I'm crying out, I need you, Lord. I need you, Lord, right now. I'm not waiting till Sunday. I'm not waiting till I get back home. I've been let down. I've been hurt. Somebody's blind. I've been cheated. I've been mistreated. But right now, God, you got to help my unbelief. As the singers begin to sing, Lord, come on, right now.
I need you, Lord, right now.
Don't sit there cute. It ain't cute time. It's passing the torch time. It's time to cry out. Don't you stand there and go through the motions. Come on, you'll leave with the same issue. But if you cry out right now, need your love. Turn his mic up a little bit, brother. Right now.
I lift my hands. I bow my knees to worship at your throne. Right now,
come on, cry out to him.
Oh, I need you, Lord. knees.
Some of you aren't going to get your breakthrough until you get this. Come on, you're still worried about your image. You're still worried about fitting in. You're still worried about just getting along with everybody. You need to cry out, cry out, cry out, cry out, cry out.
I need you, Lord.
I'm desperate, Lord.
I need you, Lord.
Right now. Come on, it don't matter who's hurt you. Cry out. Come on, cry out to God. Tell God right now, you gotta help me. I'm bitter. I'm angry. I got unbelief in my heart because I've been abused. Somebody's been molested. Somebody's been hurt. Somebody's been neglected. Give it to Him right now. Tell Him about it right now.
Lord, right now.
Some help, God.
I've
carried this thing by myself too long. I've carried this hurt. I've carried the feelings of failure. Oh, everybody's told me I'd never get it done. They've even told me I wouldn't call. They've even told me I'd never make it. The devil keeps tormenting me. Give it to him. Give it to him. Give it to him.
Oh, I lift my hand and bow my knees to worship.
Come on, young lady. Come on. Come on. God already knows. Tell him. He already knows. Come on. I know you're battling with those fears. I know you're battling with those feelings of failure. Feeling like you've let everybody down. Cry out. Cry out. That man screamed. That man didn't care what anybody thought.
Lord, I need you. I need you, Lord. Right now.
I know you got unbelief, you got fears, you got doubts. Come on, I know your baby's backslipping, cry out. Come on, I know your wife's health is causing hell in your family. Oh, I understand that, but cry out. He's able, he's able. That boy was falling at the mouth, rolling around on the ground as the devil's tormenting him. But when God got through, he was delivered. Child, I know it's been for years in your marriage. I know it's been years in your health. I know it's been years on the job. Cry out, cry out, cry out.
I've come to worship at your throne, Lord Jesus. I need you, Lord. I need you, Lord.
That's it, Pastor.
Right.
Come on. Come on. Oh, God's not through if you'll cry out. He'll help your unbelief. He'll help your unbelief. He'll help your unbelief.
Ooh, yeah. I need you, Lord. I need you, Lord, right now. I lift my hands, bow my knees to worship at your throne. I need you, Lord. I need you, Lord, right now.
I'm here crying, Lord.
I need you, Lord. Lord, I need you, Lord, right now.
I really need you, Lord.
I need you, Lord. I need you, Lord, right now. I lift my hand. I bow my knees to worship at your throne. I need you, Lord. I need you, Lord, right now.
change. God's about to do something. Come on, let him begin to build up. Come on. You're starting to feel a little something different. It's because you cried out. There's going to be a lifting in just a moment. Stay down tonight. We're not going to wallow in our pity. We're not going to wallow in our fears. If you have cried out to God, God has heard your prayer. By the time that man got to crying out, when he got through, there was a change. There was a deliverance. That boy was set free. I'm telling somebody, the Holy Ghost tonight, if you have cried out to God, he has heard your prayer. I want you to begin to praise God now like the miracle has already happened. Come on, there's a lifting that's going to take place right now. Come on, somebody's child's about to pray back through. Somebody's about to get a healing. Somebody's about to get a deliverance. I want you to cry out in a voice of triumph right now.
Shout with the voice of praise.
Come on.
Shout with the voice of praise. Shout with the voice of triumph.
Come on, I need some singers up here.
Shout
right now.
Shout with the voice of praise.
Sister Anna, get up here, help me.
Shout unto God for the victory. Hey, hey, give the Lord a shout of praise. Come on and shout with the voice of praise. Somebody shout. Somebody shout the voice of triumph. Ooh, yeah.
The voice of praise.
Somebody shout. Shout unto God for the victory. Hey, 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 hey. The Lord is God. Somebody shout.
Somebody start rejoicing.
Somebody shout. Somebody shout, shout unto God for the victory. Hey, hey,
give the Lord a shout. If you got your miracle tonight, I want to
tell you,
you
we are victorious. God is most high above the earth. Oh, he is the glory. Satan to be so I'm gonna shout with the voice of triumph. I'm gonna
Oh, victory. Shout every victory. Shout every victory. Shout every victory. Shout for the victory. Shout every victory. Shout. Shout for the victory. Shout every victory. Shout.
Shout with the boys in triumph. Shout with the boys in triumph. Shout. Thank you. coming toward him and said, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world."
Baptism, then what? Baptism is a burial in water for accountable beings into the remission of sins, for salvation, to get into Christ, to become a new creature, to get into the one body. Then, walk in the new life, study and grow, become a servant of righteousness, keep self pure, be an example, have faith in God, follow Jesus, put first things first, resist temptation, be faithful, and be fruitful.